First of all, I will call out to the police and the security agencies who have denied us the chance to have access to him. I cannot see him. I have not seen him. The lawyers have not seen him. Even when they tried the whole of yesterday and the whole of today, it is now 3 p.m. No one has had access to him. So we do not know the condition in which he is. And the police consistently denies us access to him.
Have they told you why?
No, nobody's talking to us. They keep bouncing our lawyers from one office to another. They send us from one officer to another. One says it is so-and-so in charge, and when they get to that office, they tell them it is another person in charge. And so we just do not know where to proceed to next.
Are you worried for his safety?
I am strongly worried for his safety because this has happened before. The police has held him before and given him to us, stated where we have to first take him to hospital to treat him from the wounds and everything bad that has happened to him in custody. So right now we do not know what to expect. This has happened before. Even last time when he was beaten in Arua, they kept him away from us for about 6 days. So we do not know how much more time we'll have to wait to see him, and it worries me so much.
Tell us about the kinds of conversation you've been having with your husband in terms of his political ambitions. I mean, clearly he's paying what seems to many as a very high price.
He is not the only one paying. The opposition in this country is facing a lot of ruthlessness from the police and security agencies. On the campaign, the presidential campaign, almost all opposition presidents have not been given a chance to complete one single day's rally program. So this force and this happening to him is not on him alone. It is on all the opposition parties. The ground is not leveled. There is double standards in this. The incumbent is enjoying mass gatherings and processions in the streets, and the opposition is not allowed to do anything similar to that or close to that. They're either blocked before they do it, or they're arrested and beaten and their people harassed and imprisoned before they even start talking to the congregation that has gathered for their conferences. So I think it is not on him alone. But our discussions have been about doing the best that we can to represent our people and their thoughts. And it is him that is in this position. So we just discuss what we think is the right thing to do and how to go through this process legally and how to present their voice. That's our discussion mainly.
Right. And you as his spouse obviously have concerns, and he's not in this alone. What impact is all of this having on you and your family, your immediate family?
I barely slept yesterday night, but it is not about me. Yesterday, the whole of Uganda, especially in major towns, there were uprisings, there were riots, there were strikes, demonstrations of sorts, tires were burnt, the police beat people. The police came brutally to people, tear gassed them, beat them, and shot at them with live bullets. We have a number of people who died yesterday, close to 10, and they all died in the middle of the city center, in broad daylight, in live broadcast from the mainstream media and from private Facebook accounts. Now, I cannot start thinking about myself when there are families who are grieving the death of their young ones and of their loved ones. I will not talk about myself because the other presidential candidates have not been able to continue with their program because my husband is in prison. I will not think about myself because businesses were brought to a standstill yesterday. Cars were broken in two. When I start thinking about myself, it will be selfish. I think we need to focus on what is happening generally and what came after they arrested him, which is very appalling and something that we should really condemn in the strongest terms.